Good afternoon, everyone. This is the Standing Committee on Health for May 11th, 2021. We have a mid-size agenda today with a couple of bills that I'm sure some of you have gotten many calls about, and we are many emails or tweets, et cetera, et cetera. I will be speaking about that bill shortly. So let's kick it off with S-75 by Senator Hoylman. This bill would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to adult immunization reporting requirements.
Okay, I'm gonna give Senator Hoylman an opportunity here in a second, but I wanted to make sure to lead off to establish a couple of things. First of all, vaccines are safe, effective, and necessary. I know that there's been a lot of misinformation floating around this particular bill. The length of this whole bill is one page, less than one page. And so I just wanted to get some myths that are happening. And I know that I'm being seen live and recorded, so make sure you get all of this, folks who are watching. Number one, as I said, vaccines are safe, effective, and necessary. Number two, there is an allegation that there is going to be some sort of information system created, some weird special information system is going to be created with this data. I will have you know that there already in the state of New York are regional health networks all across the state, because sharing data, medical data, is actually a way to make our system more effective, to deliver better care, to do it in a less expensive way. And I will remind everyone that these systems, which again, already exist behind thick walls of privacy, both at the federal and at the state level. Whether it's the SHINE or the statewide health information network of New York, which is the larger umbrella, or the RIOs, R-H-I-O, or regional health information organizations, they already exist. And these actually make it easier so that when you, as a patient, go to one doctor and then go to another, you have to actually consent for the information to be shared with the second doctor, but your information, which is not available publicly, and this bill would do nothing to change that, would then be available to the second practitioner so that they could make better decisions about your health. So again, regional health networks already exist. They are behind thick walls of privacy, both from the federal level and the state level, as far as laws that protect the privacy of patients. Also, there's an argument that this would actually serve to track you. Folks, if you have a phone on your pocket, you are already being tracked. So if you have concerns about this tracking, then perhaps you should throw that in the toilet and just communicate via, I don't know, Morse code or something. But in all seriousness, the allegation, the misinformation, the lies that this would serve some sort of segregation tool and a tracking tool is not accurate. What we are doing here is we're saying that the information, the private information, which again already exists, these networks already exist, and are only available to medical practitioners with your consent. It is best to have this information so we can make better decisions about how to make sure that we have, if there are certain places in the state where there's less vaccination rates, we want to make sure to go there and educate folks so they can get vaccinated. We're not forcing anyone to get vaccinated. We're just asking, pleading that you do so we can get to some level of normalcy. So I'm going to certainly let Senator Hoylman chime in here if he wishes to. But again, this is misinformation. These lies, these distortions are not accurate. And ultimately, what this bill simply does is it says that if someone who willingly takes a vaccine, who goes somewhere and says, I want to get vaccinated, then whomever provides that vaccine to that patient has to report to the state, hey, I provided a vaccine. It is not saying, now we know what one of the good ones is, so we can identify the bad ones. That is not what this is. It is a simple bill. It does nothing of the sort of creating some sort of weird tracking software, et cetera, et cetera. So I just wanted to get some of those things off of the plate. Senator Hoylman, because it is his bill, and then Senator Oberacker. Senator Hoylman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and you've done a really good job in laying out the framework of the legislation. I'll add something else. The bill doesn't even change the status quo currently. Under the executive order 202.82, which is in effect right now, all adult vaccinations, including COVID-19, are already being reported to those two registries, the New York State Immunization Information System and the New York Citywide Immunization Registry. So that's in effect. And that's actually how we're getting those maps that you see in places like the New York Times that show vaccination uptake. That's so important for public health officials to know where vaccines are being administered and where people are receiving them. That's crucial to the public health efforts to combat COVID-19. We wrote this bill before COVID-19, but it's even more important now. I'll also say that it doesn't change the reporting requirements for child vaccinations. Reporting is already mandatory in that instance. We changed that back in 2008, I think. And it doesn't expand the entities that you mentioned, Mr. Chair, that can access this information from these two registries. Of course, again, as you mentioned, the bill doesn't require anyone to receive a vaccination against their will. Rather, it's ensuring that healthcare providers have these accurate records of instances where an adult patient voluntarily chooses to receive a vaccine. Finally, I'll add two more points. The bill isn't unprecedented. New York's prescription drug monitoring program tracks controlled substance dispensing and doesn't require patient consent either. So already this information is being shared at that level. And with the passage of this bill, New York is going to join the vast majority of states, 43 states that either mandate that this information be shared without consent or rely on implied consent, which is in effect the same thing unless a patient opts out. There are only 8 states that require explicit consent to share adult immunization information. New York is one of those, and I'm sure those 7 other states are looking at changing their requirements as they try to battle this incredibly unprecedented public health crisis.
Thank you, Senator Hoylman. Senator Oberacker.
Thank you, Chairman Rivera, and also thank you for the added narrative. I think it definitely kind of puts things somewhat in perspective. But, you know, in light of what I've witnessed, and I think what some of my constituents have witnessed, the monumental failures of the state IT system, especially over this past year, concerning, you know, and more importantly, the unemployment and the vaccine, you know, the vaccine signups. I cannot support a measure that puts personal health information at risk. I think people have a legitimate privacy concerns, and I don't feel that an Albany data bank is a place where these health records really should be stored. I think if we had a little bit better track record for my last point, I would feel a little bit more comfortable, you know, with this. And for me, I'll be standing up for privacy and the personal choice on these issues. And therefore, Mr. Chairman, I will be voting no on this bill. And I thank you for the opportunity to talk.
Yes, Senator Oberacker. Senator Oberacker will be noted as a nay in this bill. I'll just say again, sir, while certainly having no considering how many issues we've had, even in our district, with folks getting unemployment, I will not argue that this is that our IT infrastructure is perfect. However, I will again repeat that regional health information organizations already exist. They have existed for years. And ultimately, this information is protected already behind federal laws and state laws. You could lose your medical license for violating these laws. And you as a patient have to give consent. This changes nothing of that. So I just wanted to clarify that. Senator Ryan.
Thank you. I had a question or two. So right now, if I go to my doctor and get a prescription filled, let's just say it's antibiotic. Then I go to my pharmacist, and it seems my pharmacist already knows about that prescription through a computer system. And if I go to my other doctor, it seems my other doctor knows that my primary care physician wrote a prescription for me. Doesn't that show that most of the medical procedures that we're doing and prescriptions and communications, we're already all linked in through a healthcare system?
So what you're describing, Senator Ryan, is precisely what regional health information organizations are meant to do. And let's back up for a second. You have the situation that you described. Obviously, we're going to use patient, we're going to use Bob as a patient. So Bob goes to a primary care physician. There's a particular disease that they're trying to treat. There's a particular treatment. Going to another doctor that's a completely different doctor, maybe not a cardiologist. Now it's another type of doctor. Having that second practitioner be able to know the tests that have already been performed, the diseases or conditions that are already being treated, the drugs that have already been prescribed, all of these things help the second practitioner make better decisions about what tests are going to be given, what prescriptions are going to be applied. And then, as you said, your pharmacist, and we're actually going to deal with something a little bit later that deals with creating a system in the state of New York whereby pharmacists could help out patients who have critical conditions and have to be managed, and the pharmacist could play a very key role in that. All of that has an information infrastructure behind it that actually helps us, again, provide better care for patients, actually makes the system cheaper because it means that tests that have been already been performed don't have to be performed again. It makes it more effective. So it's a system that already exists. Matter of fact, we need to strengthen it further. It is one of the ways that we can actually make it so that everybody is healthier and the system operates more effectively. And once again, I will repeat that the only reason why that pharmacist has your information is because you have consented to the pharmacist having that information. The only reason that the second doctor has that information is because you as a patient have consented to that information being given to them. So just wanted to underline that. Go ahead, Senator Ryan.
And under Senator Hoylman's proposal, will you have to consent to have that information shared?
What the proposal does is, as it relates to having the injection, like the actual vaccine, once you're vaccinated, the sharing of that information to the database, the bill would change it to shall. And you will be obligated as a medical practitioner to share that to have that information in the database. But for another practitioner to have access to that information, you have to consent. So all that it does is it says, if you are a nurse, a doctor, or another person who has actually given a shot to, say, patient Bob or Senator Ryan, then that information, the fact that you have received that shot, now goes into the database. But again, not publicly available, not publicly accessible. And instead, whomever your next practitioner is and your next intersection with the health system, you will have to consent at that moment for that person or that provider to be able to have the information that you
To sum it up, if I'm already going to one doctor, I get my antibiotics already, my second doctor sees that. Under this bill, if I go to my one doctor and get my shingles vaccine, it will allow my second doctor to see that?
That is correct.
And that would probably prevent me from getting vaccines I don't need or having to get counseled by my physician on why it's important to get certain vaccines if I already got them. So it doesn't seem like it's much different than the system that we already have in place.
I would agree, sir.
Interesting. Well, thank you for that clarification.
Absolutely. Thank you, Senator Ryan. Senator Boyle.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I appreciate the chairman and sponsor's goal here. I think this bill is actually counterproductive to what you're trying to do. Obviously, we saw this week, and getting back to what my colleague Senator Oberacker said about the IT situation, this week we saw a huge hack on a national level from a foreign agent. And so nothing is safe, even in the Pentagon and the bowels of whatever government agency, it's never truly safe. What I think my colleagues may not understand is the deep distrust of government that a large percentage of New Yorkers and Americans have. It's unfortunate, but they do. And so the reason I say this might be counterproductive is my phones have been lighting up for the last 2 days with hundreds and hundreds of calls opposing.
As mine have as well, sir.
And so what I believe is we're trying to get the highest percentage vaccination rate possible, obviously, to get to 70% or whatever the herd immunity is. We seem to be getting slowed down at 60%. Well, I believe we have a good percentage of New Yorkers who would actually get this vaccination. And there certainly should be a database for students or workers in a public space. No question about it. But there could be Mrs. Smith, who's 80 years old, wants to get the shot, but she doesn't want that information in the big bad government database anywhere. And so she will not get it because that is going to go to some government database. And I think that we're ultimately going to slow ourselves getting to that herd immunity because of well-meaning legislation like this. And that's why I'll have to oppose it today.
Thank you, Senator Boyle. And one more time, I will underline that there is no creation of a big bad government database. There is a health information database that already exists, and it is actually a good thing, and it exists behind barriers of privacy.
Mr. Chairman, I know that, and you know that, but the people that we want to get vaccinated don't. That's my point.
And this is why our job is, Senator Boyle, I would argue, to make sure that we correct them and to say that, unfortunately, they're being misinformed and in some instances straight up lied to. And so I think it's our responsibility to say that. But I will.
Yes, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, if I could say that.
Senator Holman.
Yeah, I think unfortunately statements, and all due respect to Senator Boyle, statements like that do more to undermine the belief in the efficacy and safety of vaccines than establishing what is already in place in New York State at the moment and what 42 states already have in place. So I think it's our responsibility to push back on those calls that we receive and emails from a small segment of our population, some of whom are not our constituents and many of whom are outside of the state of New York.
Senator Boyle, if you had any last words since your hand is still up, or are you good?
Oh, no, I'm good, sorry.
All right, thank you, Senator Boyle. Senator Oberacker.
Again, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So a question that came up in listening to the dialogue is, if there's a system already in place, then why are we more or less doubling up with this piece of legislation? What is the difference or the glaring difference between this bill and what we already have in place? If you say the information is already in there, communicated, so on.
What the bill does, and again, I would refer you, Senator Oberacker, to the bill itself, right, S-75. It changes, just as an example, this is in line 4 and 5 of Section 1B. Any healthcare provider who administers any vaccine to a person 19 years or older, currently it says may, with the consent of the vaccinee, may report all such immunizations to the department in a format prescribed, et cetera, et cetera. This changes it to shall report. So the change is that the provider shall report. So it basically says, you will say that you provided, like, I'm the doctor or the pharmacist or the nurse, et cetera. I provided a vaccine to this patient. Now I will say, I provided this vaccine to this patient. That's it. That's all this does.
So,
go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, so to go from the nomenclature may to shall, may says I have the choice to do that, shall says I don't.
That is correct.
Okay.
As a provider, as a provider, what this means is that we, because we require the most correct information, we are saying you as a provider have to, and again, it is not putting a sign on your back. It is not announcing to the universe. It is providing to the same database that I was referring to, the database that already exists, the regional health information organizations, and the SHINee or statewide health information network of New York. And there's databases that particularly deal with vaccinations, which again already exist. So basically we're saying we're going to add it to that database, which are only accessible if somebody as a patient provides the consent to be accessed by a medical practitioner.
Mr. Chairman, so with the idea of consent, so I have already been vaccinated earlier on due to my, you know, belonging to an emergency squad. I did not give consent then. Do I get a chance to give consent now? Or is that something that just by virtue of already being vaccinated, I am thrown into that category?
If I'm not mistaken, Senator Holman, you might correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that there's an executive order which already provides for this to be the case.
We're just codifying in many respects, Mr. Chair, the existing executive order that has allowed you to go and public health officials to see where vaccination uptake is occurring and where vaccination hesitancy and public health outreach needs to occur. This is important data that our health departments need as we battle COVID. This is really a matter of life or death. Yeah. If we don't get this information into public officials' hands, this is not about consent or personal freedoms. This is about making certain that everyone is protected from this ravaging pandemic. And, you know, there's a lot at stake here. So I hope our colleagues consider that when they vote.
And then just lastly, and then I'm sure you'll be happy to get to put me on mute, but the example of, like, say, having an antibiotic that, you know, is brought through the system and the information is conveyed to from the doctor to the pharmacy and so on. Again, you know, the use of certain antibiotics and or drugs of that category, they're not potentially used though as a way of saying if I have an infection and I'm not using antibiotics, I can't attend school or I can't attend this event. And I'm worried about that this information, again, or more importantly, the breach potential of this information gets out, and it could be used as a way of segregating those folks who have been vaccinated and those who choose not to. And I'm just very, very concerned about, you know, the infrastructure, Mr. Chairman, that is set up to collate this information. And I thank you for the opportunity to address. Thank you.
Absolutely, Senator Bracker. So once again, this information, I can't go in there and say, hey, as a layperson, I can't just query it and go like, hey, Bob Smith, my neighbor, is he vaccinated? Oh, he's not. Then I'm going to not invite him to my party. That is not what this does. The information exists for medical practitioners, and as Senator Holman pointed out, in a non-identifying way, to be able to say a population in a certain place is more vaccinated than others. And the reason we need to know that is because, since, let us not forget, and I'm speaking directly to the folks, and I please, please, please remember that this is a pandemic that has killed millions of people around the world. This is not a hoax. This is not a hoax. And we can be protected from it with a safe, effective vaccine. And so we need to know, as public health officials, as government officials, where we need to, not to segregate people, but where do we need to go educate? Some of the districts, some of the zip codes that I represent, at the height of the pandemic in the middle of the Bronx, were some of the folks that had the highest rates of hospitalizations, highest rates of deaths. And they, at this point, do not have very high vaccination rates. I've had to not only do mailers into those places of my district, I've had to go physically into that district, working along with local community health centers. This is about life and death. We're not trying to take away anybody's freedom. What we're trying to do is to be better informed so as a government, we can go and educate those folks who might still be unclear about whether this is a safe, effective, and necessary thing. And ladies and gentlemen, it is. Vaccines are safe, they're effective, and they are necessary. If we're to go to any type of normalcy, we need to do this to make sure that we're all vaccinated. And all this does is make certain that if there's a provider that puts a shot into the arm of an individual, then that information goes into a database that already exists and is protected by both federal and state laws. That is what we're saying here. Senator Boyle.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but you're making a point that I think is important. If you do not know that this is a very deadly virus by now, and you're not willing to take the vaccination or have your family take the vaccination, there's more to it, right? It's not because you weren't quite convinced that it's bad. And that's why I'm saying there's a difference. If you look at the groups, and I can tell you that I'm very familiar with them, you have a group of people that are totally against vaccinations, right? Anti-vaxxers, whatever you want to, whatever term there is, right? They will not get a vaccination no matter if it was the plague ravaging through this 90% death rate.
Like the plague that is plaguing us now, you mean?
It's not 90%. It's not extremely deadly. It is a deadly, deadly thing, something to be taken very seriously. But there's another group that would take vaccination, but they just don't trust the government. They don't want to have their data given to the government. I'm not talking about cell phones or whatever, but they do not trust the government. And I don't know whether that's 3%, 5%, or 10%, but it's hurting us having them not get vaccinations because they're afraid this information is going to go to the federal government or the state government in their database, and it's going to slow us getting to that 70% herd immunity. That's the only point. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments on this issue? All right, do I have a motion?
Move the bill.
Senator Thomas, seconded by Senator Brooke. All those in favor? Aye. All those opposed?
Opposed.
I have Senator Overacker, Senator Steck, Senator Rath, Senator Gallivan, Senator Boyle. Without rec, that bill is moved to first reading. That was one bill. Moving on, Senate Bill 649A by Senator Harkin. If reported, it would be referred to Finance.
An act to amend the Social Services Law and the Public Health Law in relation to medication for the treatment of substance use disorders.
Thank you. Quick question. Senator Ryan, you're still raising your hand or? Do a little button, Brian. Little button. No, Senator Boyle, I meant. There you go.
My hand raises down on my screen.
Gotcha. I just want to check. Senator Boyle is the. You were right next to each other, so I got confused. Apologies. This bill, it is referring to Medicaid patients on fee-for-service to require no prior authorization for medication-assisted treatment. Do I have any questions or comments about this bill? All right. Do I have a motion? And I see a motion for Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Kaminsky. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed?
Opposed.
Nay.
Opposed, Senator Rath, Senator Gallivan, Senator Steck, Senator Overacker. Okay, without rec. Without rec, Senator Boyle. And that bill is reported to Finance. Next bill, Senate Bill 1016A by Senator Gorin.
An act to amend the public health law and the education law in relation to directing the commissioners of education and health to establish rules and regulations for the treatment and monitoring of students of school districts, boards of cooperative educational services, and non-public schools who exhibit signs or symptoms of sudden cardiac arrest.
So this is a bill that was moved by Senator, that was presented by Senator Gorin in response to a constituent named Dominic Murray, who is a young man who had sudden cardiac arrest. So this would create a system at the state level so that we could provide better information to schools all across the state, particularly coaches and folks that work with athletes, with young athletes all over the state on sudden cardiac arrest supported by the American Heart Association. And I thank Senator Gorin for bringing it to us. And I certainly send my condolences to the Murray family and hoping that this can help them heal a little bit. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? Do I have a motion? Motion by Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? That bill moves to first reading. Next bill by Senator Gonardis, Senate Bill 1080A, that would be referred to finance if reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to establishing requirements for residential healthcare facilities during a state disaster emergency involving a disease outbreak.
So this bill would relate to cleaning. Hold on a second. Let me just make sure I get the right one. Residential healthcare facilities. So it requires more information from healthcare facilities during emergency crisis. In particular, there's two things that I just want to point out. It not only provides more clarity on how the Department of Health should act in this type of emergency, but it also sets a standard for what would happen if we find that a particular facility has a higher than average death rate of patients or residents that are living there. And it helps basically sets up an emergency protocol, if you will, for what the Department of Health to do in that instance. Do I have a question, any questions or comments on this bill? Okay, I saw Senator May, did you move the bill? Senator May moves the bill. Do I have a second? Senator Salazar, all those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Without rec, you've got Gallivan, Boyle, Oberacker, Steck. All righty, that bill is moved to finance. Next bill, Senate Bill 1121 by Senator Kaminsky. It would be referred to finance and reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law and the environmental conservation law in relation to indoor air quality in schools.
Senator Kaminsky, would you like to tell us a little bit about your bill?
No, just very briefly, there are just some things that are not monitored. We want to protect our children in our schools. And after some mercury leaks in school and other indoor air quality issues, is something we should set a standard for and monitor and make sure our children are safe. And thank you for moving this, Mr. Chair.
Absolutely, Senator Kaminsky. It prescribes a type of coordination between schools and the state. And I think it would be a positive thing to make this a reality. Do you have any questions or comments on this bill? Excuse me. Do I have a motion? I have a motion by Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Hoylman. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec? All right, that bill moves to finance. Next bill, 1169, by me, it would be referred to finance if reported on this committee.
An act to amend public health law in relation to establishing the Clinical Trial Access and Education Fund.
This is pretty self-explanatory. It establishes a fund that would actually obviously have to be funded during the budget, but it would provide during clinical trials for people that have life-threatening or disabling diseases. It would provide so that transportation services, lodging, et cetera, could be provided to these folks. It would be grants from the Department of Health. So this would establish that program. Do you have any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? I have Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator Biagi. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? And that bill moves to finance. Next bill, Senate Bill 2022A by Senator May. It would move to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to directing the Department of Health to make publicly available the results of all inspections conducted by such department in nursing homes and other residential healthcare facilities in the state during the COVID-19 state disaster emergency and thereafter.
Gotcha. Senator May, would you like to share with us something about the bill?
Sure. This is part of a whole number of bills that we have, some of which we've passed before, one of which was the Senator Gonardis bill that we just passed through committee. To improve transparency and accountability with nursing homes. This one is a key piece of that effort because it will allow residents and their families and anyone who's looking for a nursing home to know what the findings are of DOH inspections. There is a 5-star rating that's a federal thing, but it's woefully inadequate. And I think it's really hard to get accurate information about how nursing homes are doing, especially in crises like this one. So I'm grateful to you for bringing this forward.
Absolutely, Senator May. Any questions or comments about this bill?
Question?
Senator Galvin.
I do have a question. It requires a posting within 30 days. When does that 30-day time clock start?
I defer to staff, but I feel it probably refers to when it is passed. Would that be correct?
Yeah.
One second. Maybe Senator May knows the answer to the question. If not, we can go right to the text of the bill. Go ahead, get over here.
Yeah, I believe it's 30 days from when the results of the inspection are completed by DOH.
Gotcha.
Not necessarily 30 days from when the inspection happens.
Does it take into account the dispute resolution process?
I don't believe there's a reference to that in here. Do you mean the ability of the nursing home to correct the violations?
Exactly.
Yeah, so that already is involved in the on DOH's website. They already have a list of violations, and then if the violations are corrected. So this is kind of another piece incorporated into that. But I believe they would still need to post the inspection. And then later on, once the violation is corrected, that would also be posted as well.
Any further questions, Senator Galvin?
No, I am going to go without rec now. Just solely, I've got to look into that a little bit more on the potential that it may cause some confusion for the consumer, and there might be some overlap with that. But thanks for providing the answer. But I will be without rec at this point.
Gotcha. And certainly, I'm sure you can touch base with Senator May if you think that there's something that could be done to, you know, I'm sure that there's more questions that you could answer. All right. Do I have any further questions or comments? Do I have a motion? I have a motion by Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator Biaggi. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? And I know that at least Senator Galavan is without rec. Any other without recs? All right, I got Senator Galavan without rec. That bill moves to first reading. Next bill, Senate Bill 2212 by Senator Sepulveda.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to prohibiting approved organizations in the Child Health Insurance Plan from limiting the participation of certain health care providers.
Pretty self-explanatory. It just prohibits insurance companies that administer Child Health Plus from requiring the participating healthcare providers, doctors, et cetera, also sign up for their other healthcare networks that are operated by the insurer. Any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? I see a motion from Senator Kaminsky, seconded by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? Without rec, I got Rath, Steck, Galavan, Overacker. That bill moves to first reading. Next bill, Senate Bill 2543 by me. It would be referred to finance if it's reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to payments for personal protective equipment for home and community-based long-term care services.
And we've actually passed this bill before. It would mandate that there's a that is relates to revenue that MLTCs have received, particularly during the pandemic, that there's a pass through so that home health agencies could actually get access to money to purchase PPE for their workers. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? See a motion from Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator Biaggi. All those in favor, aye. Opposed? Without rec? Without rec, got Rath, Steck, Galavan, and Oberacker. And I know that Biaggi is going off of camera every time to play with her dog. I got it. I understand. You can play with your dog on the camera. It's fine.
I have a dog. It's a cat.
Oh, it's a cat. Okay. I knew that there was something furry on the side there that was like that you were playing with. So it's the cat.
I apologize.
So I get it without rec from the cat. Got it. All right, that bill is referred to finance. Next bill by Senator Sepulveda, Senate Bill 4520, and it would be referred to finance and reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to expanding the Doctors Across New York program to include dentists.
This is pretty, again, self-explanatory. It would be renamed since it would extend extend this program to also include dentists in the loan repayment program. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? A motion. I saw Senator Rath kind of start moving. I said seconded by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? That bill is reported to finance. Next, Senate Bill 4685 by me. It will be reported to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law and the Surrogate Court Procedure Act in relation to restoring medical futility as a basis for both surrogate consent to a do not resuscitate order and for a do not resuscitate order for a patient without a surrogate.
So there's a couple of bills that we're doing today that that seek to make some clarifications in the language. See, there's the cat, see? No. That seek clarification as it relates to the do not resuscitate process in the state of New York. In particular, this one, the second one is very technical, as it just makes a couple of corrections as far as terms. In this case, we are including again the definition of medical futility. It is one that requires for two physicians to make a determination that a person that it would be medically futile to resuscitate the patient. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? I have Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Holman. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Opposed, we got Senator Rath, Senator Overacker, Senator Gallivan. Without rec? Oh, Steck is are you, you're without rec? Okay, so Senator Steck is without rec, and that bill moves to first reading. Next, Senate Bill 4965 by me, it would move to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law and the social services law in relation to automatic enrollment and recertification simplification for Medicaid eligible recipients.
This is also pretty self-explanatory. It would just create a automatic enrollment for folks that are Medicaid recipients in New York State. So it would make it easier for them to continue to be enrolled. Do you have any questions or comments on this bill? Do I have a motion? I have a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Biagi. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? Without rec, Senator Rath, Steck, Overacker, Gallivan. And that bill moves to first reading. Almost there, folks. Senate Bill 5139 by me. It would be referred to finance if reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the use of monies from the Community Healthcare Revolving Capital Fund.
So this would, again, it's very self-explanatory. It would expand. There's a fund that exists right now. We funded it at $19.5 million. Currently, these types of facilities, community healthcare providers can access it for capital expenses, and we want to expand that for technology, for training, debt restructuring, et cetera. So it's just kind of expanding what they would be able to access the money for. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? I see a motion from Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? Without rec, Senator Oberacker, Steck, and Gallivan. And that bill moves to finance. Next, Senate Bill 5327 by me. It would be reported to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to making technical, minor, and coordinating amendments regarding healthcare agents and proxies, decisions under the Family Healthcare Decisions Act, and non-hospital orders not to resuscitate.
This is the second bill that I was referring to earlier. It just updates the law in certain technical terms, that are no longer utilized, changes agency names, et cetera. It is strictly a technical bill. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? Okay, do I have a motion? I see a motion from Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Hoylman. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Opposed, Gallivan and Senator Rath. Without rec? I see Senator Seck, Senator Overacker. All right, that bill moved to first reading. Next bill, Senate Bill 5885 by Senator Steck.
an act to authorize certain healthcare professionals licensed to practice in other jurisdictions to practice in this state in connection with an event sanctioned by the World Triathlon Corporation and providing for the repeal of such provisions upon expiration thereof.
Senator Steck, would you like to say something about your bill?
Actually, thanks, Chairman. I would. I want to thank you. This is the first time that I've been moving this bill through the Senate, but I carried it with Senator Little back in the Assembly. We are, and I want to thank you and your staff. The Assembly majority had an issue with the end date, and so we are amending the bill to move it back from, I think, August 1st to, I think, July 28th. But again, we do this all the time, and I appreciate this bill going through your committee. Thank you.
Absolutely, sir. Glad to move it. Any questions or comments for Senator Steck? Is he going to run in the triathlon? That's my question, but I'm just new. Okay, that's fine. I will not do it either. Do I have a motion? I have a motion by Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator Rath. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? And that bill moves to first reading. Next bill, Senator Breslin, by Senator Breslin, Senate Bill 6110 would move to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law and the education law in relation to comprehensive medication management and to amend Chapter 21 of the laws of 2011, amending the education law, relating to authorizing pharmacists to perform collaborative drug therapy management with physicians in certain settings in relation to making the provisions of such chapter permanent.
So this would this is the one I was referring to earlier. It would be a voluntary, it would create the ability for doctors and pharmacists to be able to work together, particularly in conditions where you have particularly medically fragile folks or people who need a very close monitoring of their drugs or whatever therapy. And it would, so this is called comprehensive medication management, and it would allow for it to happen in the state of New York. Glad that we are thankful for Senator Breslin for bringing it up. Do I have any questions or comments on this bill? All right, do I have a motion? Motion by Senator Biagi, seconded by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? And that bill moves to first reading. And last, but certainly not least, by Senator May, Senate Bill 6201, it will be referred to finance if it's reported out of this committee.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to allowing geriatricians to apply for both the physician loan repayment program and the physician practice support program.
Senator May, would you like to comment on your bill?
I would, thank you, Mr. Chair. So even before the pandemic, the New York Times ran an article about the lack of geriatricians in America. They said we need about 33,000 by 2025, and we have about 7,000. And they give a good sense of what geriatricians do in this article too, which was published in January of 2020. They help people age with dignity. They help them stay active longer and manage a whole range of different issues that arise from sleep issues to food, eating issues to pain management to mood and memory changes and isolation and all kinds of things. And the real problem is they don't get paid enough. And we as a society don't value care of our elders the way we should. So this bill isn't going to solve that problem, but it's going to take us one step in the right direction with both recognizing the importance of this field and providing some additional financial incentive for, especially for younger medical students and young doctors to think about this as a area of specialization. So I'm grateful to you for bringing it forward and to my colleagues for, I hope you'll support it.
Grateful for you for presenting the bill, Senator May. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill? Senator Holman, you were moving it or you had a question?
I was moving it.
You were, do I have a motion? Senator Holman, seconded by Senator Kaminsky. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Rachel? You kind of went like this when I said opposed. No, Rachel May supports her own bill, but those folks without rec. Do you have any without recs? That bill moves to finance. Folks, thank you so much. We got one more committee. Let's see if we can make it another eventful one. Have a great day. This meeting is adjourned.